Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents This Narrow Space, a pediatric oncologist, his Jewish, Muslim, and Christian patients, and a hospital in Jerusalem, by Elisha Waldman, read by Barry Abrams. Try to remember some details. Try to remember some details. Remember the clothing of the one you love, so that on the day of loss, you'll be able to say, last seen wearing such and such, brown jacket, white hat. Try to remember some details, for they have no face, and their soul is hidden, and their crying is the same as their laughter, and their silence and their shouting rise to one height, and their body temperature is between 98 and 104 degrees, and they have no life outside this narrow space, and they have no graven image, no likeness, no memory, and they have paper cups on the day of their rejoicing, and paper cups that are used once only. Try to remember some details, for the world is filled with people who were torn from their sleep, with no one to mend the tear. And unlike wild beasts, they live each in his lonely hiding place, and they die together on battlefields and in hospitals. And the earth will swallow all of them, good and evil together, like the followers of Korah, all of them in their rebellion against death, their mouths open till the last moment, praising and cursing in a single howl. Try to remember some details. Yehuda Amichai. 1. Protocols. I'm sure I've been here before, but I can't remember exactly when. Perhaps when I was younger, on one of our summer vacations in Israel, hiking in the cool forest or exploring one of the ancient churches in the village. But maybe I'm just imagining it, willing the feeling into existence. All I know, as I drive down into the valley of Ein Kerem in Jerusalem, is that everything here feels familiar. And when I walk through the doors of the Department of Pediatric Hematology Oncology at Hadassah Hospital, it feels as though I'm arriving at a place that I know from my dreams. As I make my way down the corridor, the first thing I see is two boys, no more than 4 years old, sitting alongside each other, playing at a low table in the waiting area. In one poignant snapshot, they capture all of my Zionist ideals. They would be indistinguishable from any other kids their age, except for the fact that they both have the shiny, immaculately bald scalps that are the unmistakable byproducts of chemotherapy treatments. Oblivious to the dull hospital decor, the lifeless fluorescent illumination, the bustle that surrounds them, the pain and the drama that are endemic to a place like this, the boys work side by side with brightly colored construction paper and crayons. One, whose kippah has slipped off his head and lies upended on the table, is obviously Jewish. He's hunched over his project, focusing so intently on collaborating with the little boy next to him that he doesn't even notice his kippah has come off. The other boy, closely attended by a woman in a long abaya and hijab, is clearly Muslim. The boys play together, sharing crayons and comparing creations as though nothing, not religion, not cancer, not politics or war, could get in the way. For a liberal American Jewish pediatric oncologist at the start of his career, it's the Zionist dream come true. And it's for this that I've made Aliyah, moving to Israel from the United States. It's March of 2007, it's my first day on the job, and I'm eager to begin. I hurry past the boys, on my way to meet with my first patient. Though unhappy families may indeed be unhappy in their own way, My experience has been that when it comes to children facing life-threatening illnesses, unhappy families often actually have a great deal in common. I am relying on this theory for guidance as I begin my new job as attending physician at Hadassah, hoping to translate my experience in the United States into practice here in Israel. Despite the obvious cultural differences, I figure the common language of illness will provide a bridge to ease me into my new environment. On this first day of work, I am still awash in the exuberance and sense of limitless possibility that is typical of comfortably situated expats who have made Aliyah. As my patient and her parents walk into the exam room, before even a word is exchanged, I recognize the familiar tension from so many similar situations I'd experienced in New York. I glance down at my patient's chart. Lena, a 17-year-old Israeli Arab, has been having increasing pain in her left leg over the past 2 months. A recent X-ray showed what looked like a mass, and a biopsy has now determined that Lena has osteosarcoma, a malignant tumor of bone. There is no evidence that the tumor has spread elsewhere, so her prognosis is relatively good, about a 70% chance of long-term survival. But the treatment will be far from simple, and the outcome far from certain. Lena and her parents have come here today to hear the results of all the recent testing. They have undoubtedly gathered hints from previous meetings with my colleagues that this may turn out to be cancer. After all, they have come to a place called Department of Pediatric Hematology Oncology. But I know they are hoping, until the very moment that I give them the diagnosis, that this will all turn out to be a horrible mistake. My role at Hadassah is to oversee the care of children with sarcomas, which are any one of a myriad number of solid tumors that form in such areas as the bone, muscle, and connective tissue. Because this is my first day and I'm still getting oriented, I will be joined by the director of the department, Dr. Mickey Weintraub, who already met with Lena and her parents at her initial referral. I'm grateful for his presence. Although I have spent a great deal of my pre-Aliyah life in Israel, I even attended medical school in Tel Aviv, and there is much that should be familiar to me, the way these initial conversations are carried out is so important in shaping the ongoing relationship between oncologist and patient, so critical in setting the stage for how decisions will be made, that I am wary of diving in by myself on my first day. I have, over the past few years, done this many times in the United States, first as a trainee, and then for a year and a half as an attending physician. But I find myself worrying about the language barrier, the cultural nuances, the way in which I should be both delivering information and responding to cues from this young woman and her family. The intimacy of these discussions can be intense, and though this intimacy can be deeply rewarding, it can also be intimidating. I have taken up residence in Israel feeling fairly linguistically and culturally competent, able to manage the activities of daily living, but telling a 17-year-old Israeli Arab that she has a life-threatening condition is a very different challenge. In many ways, I feel I am starting my training all over again. When Lena and her parents arrive, I am still preparing the office for the meeting, organizing chairs, getting the clutter out of the way, making sure there are tissues on the desk, unobtrusive but handy, available for the tears that will surely come. As they enter, I try to compensate for the language barrier by smiling and giving them a hearty shalom. I come around from behind the desk and stick my hand out in greeting. Lena, limping, lags behind, so her mother is the first person to whom I offer my hand. She stares at it awkwardly, and everyone stops, unsure what to do. It takes a moment for me to register that both she and her daughter are wearing hijabs, and that for them, physical contact with any man other than immediate family members is prohibited. Lena's father kindly rescues us, dodging around his wife and thrusting his hand into mine, pumping it firmly, while Lena and her mother slide into their seats. I retreat behind the desk. I am already worried that I have just compounded this family's anxiety by introducing an element of cultural discomfort. I realize how much I'm worrying, and I worry even more that they can sense this. Mickey and the Arabic-speaking social worker have not yet arrived, leaving us all drowning together in a tense, painful silence. My Arabic is barely good enough at this point to say good morning, let alone to make small talk to try to put them at ease, and Lena's parents speak virtually no Hebrew. Perhaps it's better that way. They can't start asking me difficult questions while I am feeling new, alone, and exposed. I pointlessly tidy the desktop while we all smile uncomfortably at one another. I mostly try to avoid making eye contact with Lena's parents, though I can feel their eyes probing my face, my body language, for some hint as to what is coming. Lena is slouched down in her seat. She's a lanky teenager, with her hair modestly covered in a plain blue headscarf. She is also wearing a rhinestone-studded sweatshirt, blue jeans, and sneakers. It's a curious and charming blend of Western teenage fashion and Middle Eastern religious sensibility. Sparkles of glitter on her sneakers remind me that though we are about to have a very adult conversation, this young woman is still in many ways a child. She stares at the floor. I sense she must know in her heart what she is about to hear. I take some comfort in the elements here that are familiar. Mentally breaking the situation down into its fundamental components and reviewing the steps we are about to take. In oncology training, we learn the concept of the day one talk, the essential elements that a clinician must cover in order to start moving forward with treatment. These include explaining what cancer is, why it is so dangerous, and what type of cancer the patient has. We also discuss treatments and their side effects and risks. And somewhere in there, though we focus on hope, we bring up the possibility of death. Lena's thin, bony arms, evident under the loose sleeves of her hoodie, as well as her slightly sunken cheeks, tell me that she is already suffering the metabolic effects of having a large and growing tumor in her body. This is the paradox of cancer. Exuberantly unrestrained cells keep dividing with no respect for boundaries or pacing, no ear for the rhythm of life. And this is what leads to death. Once we have navigated the day one talk, there are procedures that will have to be scheduled before treatment can begin. There will be an echocardiogram to make sure Lena's cardiac muscle can handle the chemotherapy and to establish a baseline to monitor for future damage, a hearing test for similar reasons, and perhaps the removal and freezing of an ovary to mitigate the infertility that will almost certainly result from the chemo. We will need to reserve an operating room for the insertion of a port under the skin of Lena's chest, a silicon bubble attached to a small tube that feeds into a deep blood vessel. Inserting a needle through the skin and into the bubble with each course of chemotherapy will lessen the possibility of infection and allow for safer administration of our toxic medications. Reviewing these elements calms me, my own Buddhist-like mantra. There is a moment of quiet just before the discussion with the patient begins, similar to what I imagine goes on backstage at a performance as the actors take their places before the curtain rises. I experience it as though time has slowed, and I wonder if the patients and their families experience the same thing, these last few moments when they can hope that this will all just go away. It's a time when even I sometimes fantasize that this is simply a bad dream from which I can awake, and the child will be fine. I use this time to clear my thoughts, to say a quiet prayer to any God that may be listening, for wisdom and clarity in what we are about to do. As if sensing my readiness, Mickey and the social worker finally arrive, and we can begin. A native-born Israeli Jew, Mickey is a kind and unassuming man. He leads by example, rarely resorts to discipline, and is deeply loved by staff and patients alike. A full 3 years before making Aliyah, I met him while on a job scouting visit to Israel and knew within minutes that someday I would end up working for this man. I find myself addressing him as boss or sir as a half-joking sign of respect. He would never expect anyone to treat him with such formality, though he very much deserves it. He's omnipresent in the department, and I will come to appreciate how much his calm demeanor contributes to the safe space that this place represents. The social worker is a young Israeli Arab woman who is here as much to lend support to Lena and her family as to act as a translator and cultural mediator for us. Mickey begins gently but with purpose, and the discussion proceeds rapidly. He moves deftly, like an experienced surgeon, neatly dissecting layer after layer of tissue to expose an injured organ, following a template that I am more or less familiar with from the United States. It again strikes me that there are elements of this work that are universal. Regardless of nationality, ethnicity, or religion, the goals and challenges of the day one talk are pretty basic. In this first meeting, the family will likely absorb only a limited amount of the information presented. Give them what they need to begin the process, but recognize that, as treatment progresses, there will have to be many more discussions to reinforce what we are attempting to convey and to elaborate on it as necessary. The conversation takes on its own rhythm, in part because of the need for translation. I have worked through interpreters in the past, but perhaps because I'm full of adrenaline, at this moment I am particularly aware of this rhythm. Mickey and I speak English with each other, conferring about what information to present next or how to respond to a question. He then conveys our response in Hebrew to the social worker, who in turn translates it into Arabic for Lena and her parents. They respond in Arabic, which is translated back to Hebrew by the social worker, and Mickey then translates it into English for me to make sure I understand. The whole process, while in some respects cumbersome, takes on an ebb and flow that provides, at least for me, a certain comfort. The pauses allow me time to think, to evaluate their responses, to watch their body language, and to think about where we should next steer the conversation. I know from past experience that these discussions can easily devolve into fear, anger, or even outright panic. But now, the very regularity of the conversational rhythm gives the room a sense of order and control that I, and hopefully the family, find reassuring. Lena does not speak. Her mother, wide-eyed, lips trembling, fingers working a tear-soaked tissue to shreds, radiates waves of desperation as she speaks. No translation is necessary. Lena's father, buttoned down, expressionless, asks just one or two concrete, pragmatic questions. Prognosis, next steps. They return again and again to the leg and the question of amputation. We assure them that almost all tumors like Lena's can be removed with limb-sparing surgery, but we also slip in that we can't make any promises, that it is a surgical decision, and that it depends in part on how the tumor responds to the chemotherapy. In short, that we hope, but we don't know for certain. Typically, patients with this sort of tumor start off with about 3 months of chemotherapy, both to shrink the tumor and to mop up any cancerous cells that may have already escaped and spread, in numbers too low to detect, to other parts of the body. We hope that amputation will not be necessary, but starting cancer therapy is something of an act of faith, with many unknowns down the road. The meeting draws to a close. There is only so long a patient and her family can be subjected to this sort of conversation, and we want to allow them time to process what they have been told, to formulate new questions, and to begin to adjust to their new reality. And we too must move on. Despite the intimacy of these meetings, they are often just one in a series of many similar interactions throughout the day, and we have to be mindful of the need to allow other children to be seen, to give other parents the opportunity to ask questions. It almost feels deceitful the way we carefully orchestrate these interactions, so full of emotion, only to repeat the scene moments later in another room, but with a different set of players. It's not that the emotions are false, the empathy we convey fabricated, but there is something manufactured about the way in which we are genuinely present in each discussion while still managing to create some emotional space within ourselves for the next one. It's a skill, though not one you're ever taught. And it's certainly a skill that, if not done well, runs risks either of clinician burnout or of projecting insincerity to patients. But I'm young and I'm still trying to figure this all out, to understand where to put all this baggage as the day races on from patient to patient. In wrapping up with Lena's family, we emphasize the positive, stressing the fact that most children with this type of tumor survive. We focus on the next steps. We present them with a printed-out description of the treatment protocol, a standardized map of all planned treatments, which in Lena's case is specific for the management of osteosarcoma. The protocol outlines day by day and week by week all the specifics of treatment, including what type of chemotherapy will be given, routes of administration, doses, rates, and various possible adjustments. It shows us when to pause, when to reevaluate, when to stop, and when to consider a different approach. Of course, it doesn't capture the innumerable elements we can't foresee and that are so much harder to quantify, such as the side effects, the nausea, the weakness, the fevers and infections, and of course, the dreaded cancer recurrences. Though they may appear frightening, even overwhelming at first, especially as families assess line after line of difficult treatments, at the same time, these protocols, each tailored for a different type of cancer, outline a path to a cure, and therefore may provide a measure of comfort. Just as the rhythm of the translated conversation comforted me, despite the element of fear and danger in the room, so a treatment protocol may, in its regularity and predictability, impart to families and clinicians alike a sense of safety and control. Protocols give us at least some sense of what to expect, to see what is coming. They allow us to impose some sort of order on a life that has been thrown into chaos and uncertainty. Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel, one of the great Jewish thinkers of the 20th century, writes about the architecture of time. He discusses the idea specifically in the context of ritual and the religious calendar, suggesting that if we don't know where things begin and end, we can't possibly know where we are now, resulting in a distressing and even destructive inability to locate ourselves in space and time. Religious ritual and the sacred calendar help create this architecture of time, forging a structure of safe space and rhythm in an otherwise chaotic and unpredictable world. Pediatric oncology treatment protocols work the same way. They become sacred calendars, a set of rituals allowing us, in the face of danger and uncertainty, to locate ourselves, giving us a sense of how we might safely navigate what lies ahead. As we present Lena and her parents with the protocol, our intention is for them to find comfort in having a plan, in knowing that there is a clearly delineated timeline and set of rituals that will ultimately carry them safely to the end. Before they leave, we also lay out a more immediate plan for the next few days, before the chemotherapy begins. The social worker plans to follow up the next day by phone, and in 2 days, Lena will return to complete her pre-treatment tests. We say our farewells, and despite the nature of the meeting, I feel encouraged. Though, of course, my heart goes out to Lena, this is exactly why I came to Israel, for the opportunity to navigate the new languages, the blend of cultures, the political complexity. This family is at once foreign and familiar to me, a piece of the beautiful cultural jigsaw puzzle that is Israel. Lena's family is ethnically Palestinian Arab, but they live just outside of Jerusalem, within the city's municipal boundaries, and are therefore Israeli citizens. They are Muslims living in a predominantly Jewish Western society. Despite my earlier anxiety, I am already looking forward to our next meeting, to engaging more deeply with them. As a newly minted Israeli, I am here not just as an observer, not as a tourist, but as someone participating in and actively engaging with society in a meaningful way. I am contributing not just to the healthcare system, but also to the entire Zionist enterprise. And I feel a euphoric sense that I have become a part of a historical movement. Although my job is in Jerusalem, when I moved to Israel, I decided to live in Tel Aviv and endure the hour-long daily commute. Tel Aviv is commonly, and not always kindly, referred to as the bubble because it can feel so insulated from the chaos and conflict that seem to dominate the rest of the country. A vibrant, dynamic mix of Mediterranean and Western, it is the Middle Eastern version of the city that never sleeps. I was also drawn to Tel Aviv's large expat community. In Tel Aviv, I feel engaged with the modern, forward-looking side of the country, the Israel that is known and admired throughout the world for its dozens of high-tech industries, the Israel glowingly portrayed in Dan Senor and Saul Singer's book, Startup Nation. But in Jerusalem, interacting with Lena and her family, I also feel engaged, albeit in a different way. Jerusalem, with its Jewish, Christian, and Muslim holy places, seems to me more like the Israel I had grown up learning about in my conservative Hebrew day school in Connecticut. I also have many fond memories of the summers I had spent in Jerusalem as a child, with my parents and my younger brother and sister. But now, more than 20 years later, as a new immigrant, I get the sense that Jerusalem is becoming more and more defined by its Orthodox Jewish population. In Tel Aviv, I keep running into old friends, including some who are modern Orthodox, who have relocated from Jerusalem, complaining that it lacks the energy of Tel Aviv and that the religious atmosphere and poverty there are becoming unbearable. I sense that Jerusalem would be better suited to a more observant and settled-down version of myself. For now, the buzz of Tel Aviv feels right for me. When I attended medical school in Tel Aviv in the mid-1990s, I discovered Tel Aviv's exciting social and cultural scene. It was as though a version of New York had been transplanted onto Israel's Mediterranean coast. Now, as a single guy in my mid-30s, I definitely prefer spending my non-working hours here. On the other hand, Jerusalem echoes with thousands of years of history. Every rock and tree is rich with meaning. It is in Jerusalem that I feel I am earning my place in the larger historical Zionist mission. By dividing my time between Jerusalem and Tel Aviv, I feel like I am straddling the two great realities of Israel, the city that encompasses the ancient, rich roots of our people, and the city that embodies the glories of the modern state of Israel. The daily drive to work, though in some respects a hassle, captures this for me, and sometimes in my car, I am overwhelmed with what I acknowledge is a corny but deeply moving sense of my place in the sweep of history. Leaving the ancient port of Jaffa behind me, from which Jonah fled from God's summons only to be swallowed by a whale, I drive toward Jerusalem, passing through the Ayalon Valley, where the Bible tells us that Joshua asked the sun and moon to stand still, then past the old British fortress at Latrun, which was converted after its capture during the Six-Day War in 1967 to the Armored Corps Memorial and Museum, and then through the narrow pass of Sha'ar Hagai, Bab el-Wad in Arabic, a critical point in the Arab siege of Jerusalem during the War of Independence in 1948. On the return trip, after a hard day at the hospital, the coastal plain unfolds in front of me, with the lights of Tel Aviv sparkling in the distance under the setting sun. I find myself thinking about Lena as the days pass between our initial meeting and her follow-up appointment, and I wonder what is going on in her head. Has she told her sisters, her teachers, her friends? I'm busy settling into my new job and meeting new patients, but all the while, I'm anticipating Lena's return. I look forward to starting her therapy, and I hope, getting her on the road to a cure. But Lena and her parents don't show up for their appointment. No phone calls, no messages, nothing. After many attempts, the social worker finally reaches Lena's mother by phone and gets a vague excuse as to why they missed the appointment. Over the next 2 weeks, we get a series of excuses for their ongoing absence, a family wedding, a test at school, a sibling sick at home. Finally, it comes out. They have become convinced that Lena's leg will have to be amputated, and they are paralyzed by the mere thought of it. Mickey has already shared with me his suspicion that this was the reason for their non-appearance, and while I sputter in disbelief and bemoan the delay in starting treatment, he seems unruffled and takes it in stride. He tells me about a former patient, a Palestinian child whose father declared that he'd rather have a dead daughter than a daughter without a leg. The thought nauseates me. What could possibly drive someone to say that about his own child? Is their cultural fear of disfigurement so strong? How can concern about social devaluation and the possibility of not marrying off a child be so strong as to make her death preferable? Just as I am feeling the excitement of belonging, of fitting into my new home, I am acutely aware of how foreign this place is. In America, the parents' response was usually extreme too, but in the completely opposite direction. Most families in the United States did not even want to wait for the chemotherapy to run its months-long course. They just wanted their child's tumor out as quickly as possible. Why play games, they would ask. A child can live without a limb, and I could understand the impulse behind this. There is a life-threatening tumor in your child's body, and you want it removed immediately, whatever the cost. It seems intuitive that the longer it remains there, the more dangerous it becomes. It took time to explain to families that starting treatment with chemotherapy is an important step in eradicating any tumor cells that may already be circulating in the body, away from the site of the tumor, and undetectable on MRIs, magnetic resonance imagings, or PET, positron emission tomography scans. That limb-sparing surgery would not increase the overall risk of a recurrence. But this is new for me, the experience of having a family refuse to bring their child in to begin treatment for fear of an amputation that is still very theoretical and unlikely to be necessary. We offer to meet with Lena and her family to go over everything again, to explain the importance of getting started, and to re-emphasize the likelihood of cure. But all of our cajoling via the social worker doesn't seem to help. There must be some magic word I'm not saying, some key that could unlock the box in which all their fears and frustrations are stuck. Still basking in the glow of my new citizenship, I may feel that at last I belong to this incredible place, but there is clearly still so much for me to figure out. 2. Off the Map. It's July 2006, and I'm in the departure lounge in Guatemala City Airport, returning to the United States from a vacation. A static-filled television proclaims that war has broken out between Israel and Hamas fighters based in Gaza. I had finished my training as a pediatric oncologist exactly 1 year earlier, had joined a well-established medical practice, moved into a spacious apartment in the suburbs with my girlfriend, and paid off my medical school debts. I seemed to be well on the road to a comfortably settled adulthood. But then, over the course of that year, I broke up with my girlfriend, moved into a smaller, more modest apartment, and discovered that private practice medicine probably wasn't a good fit for me. I was also facing a growing crisis of faith. I had grown up in suburban Connecticut in a fairly observant Jewish home, the oldest son of a conservative rabbi. I attended a Jewish day school, where Judaism and Israel-oriented topics composed a significant part of the curriculum through the seventh grade. In college, I majored in religious studies despite my father's wry, self-deprecating warning that I would discover that everything about religion is either made up or stolen. But despite learning through the course of those studies that his joke might not be that far off from the truth, I'd always maintained a fair degree of religious observance. Even after questioning the roots of my religious traditions, perhaps even because of that questioning, I felt that I emerged from my studies all the more engaged with and nurtured by my faith. Though I ate at non-kosher restaurants, I limited myself to vegetarian food. Though I turned the lights on and off and watched television on the Sabbath, I didn't use the phone, travel by car, or write, and for the most part, I stayed home for a quiet observance of the day of rest. I attended synagogue on many, if not most, Sabbaths, and always on holidays. Working in pediatric oncology challenged all that, as I increasingly felt that my daily experiences were at odds with what I had always held true about the place of religion in the world. The constant exposure to suffering and death meant it no longer felt safe or comforting to hear that things happen for a reason, or that things work out in the end. What I saw every day at work belied such silly platitudes. About 75-80% of children with cancer do survive, counting all forms of cancer together, but that still means that almost 1 out of 4 children diagnosed with cancer dies. During my general pediatric residency, my exposure to patient deaths was modest. This is not to say those children's deaths didn't affect me, but I could somehow rationalize them away by mentally isolating them as rare exceptions. After 3 years in general pediatrics training, drawn to the challenges of caring for children with complex and life-threatening illness, I went on to a 3-year fellowship in pediatric hematology oncology. Despite the difficulty of working with such seriously ill and so many dying children, something about the work resonated with me. Part of it was the drama, the extreme situations, and high stakes. The practice of medicine definitely involves a certain amount of ego, and I loved doing something that I knew was intimidating for many other doctors. But it was more than just that. There was a personal challenge inherent in the work as well. In the same way that I had studied theology in college, in part because of the way it challenged my personal beliefs, the experience of working with extremely ill children and their families also inserted itself into my soul in a way that left me uncomfortable and thinking about how I lived my own life. It was during my fellowship that death, suffering, and the challenges of how to cope with them became a part of my daily routine. I had begun my general pediatric residency training in 1998, not long after the New England Journal of Medicine published what was then considered to be a breakthrough paper by Dr. Joanne Wolfe, a pediatric oncologist in Boston who would go on to become an important figure in the then-emerging field of pediatric palliative care. Dr. Wolf and her colleagues found that almost all children with cancer who died did so with significant and poorly managed suffering. My experience matched Dr. Wolf's findings. The children who died did so uncomfortably, and even the children who survived experienced terrible suffering in the process of getting there. This book is in part about those children who don't survive, but it's also about those who do survive, but in a manner that leaves them changed in ways that are hard for most of us to grasp. It's about children for whom things don't work out according to hopes or expectations. It's about their families, who are also changed forever, and the clinicians who care for them. And because it's set in Israel, one of the most complex places on earth, it's also about individuals, communities, and even entire nations for whom things don't work out according to hopes or expectations. And ultimately, it's about how all of these experiences changed me and my own expectations. During my fellowship, the pace of my training was frantic enough that I was largely spared or prevented from having to truly process any of the suffering I saw. The necessity of moving on and caring for the next child did not allow for much time to sit and reflect, so that my experience of patient death was broad, but not so deep. There were isolated moments here and there, sometimes shared with other clinicians, or even at times with the children themselves and their families, when time would slow down and there would be some mutual acknowledgement of the sadness, and sometimes even the beauty, of our shared experience. But for the most part, those moments were rare gems meant to be pocketed and privately treasured, and not openly displayed in front of others in the midst of training. When the fellowship ended, I joined a much smaller pediatric hematology oncology practice. I lasted a year there. The pace of the clinical work was slower, and there was now time to reflect. Though the number of dying children seen by the practice was much smaller than what I had experienced during my fellowship, each death seemed to land on me with a heavier thud. At one point, my pent-up feelings about all of the suffering I had witnessed suddenly exploded, like one of those gag cans with a spring-loaded snake that leaps out when you loosen the lid. The deaths I witnessed that year, as well as the lived experiences of those who survived, were intense. There was the little girl with relapsed leukemia after a bone marrow transplant, whose strong-willed mother, despite our attempts to dissuade her, demanded more and more chemotherapy in the hope that something would work, until death ended the debate in the form of an overwhelming infection that filled her veins with an evil mix of chemotherapy, leukemia, and bacteria. A lovely 4-year-old boy with great maturity and an astonishing air of ownership over his fate would proudly report in detail each week on how he was feeling until he ultimately succumbed to a vicious leukemia that refused to respond to any therapy. There was a 6-year-old I never really got to know because by the time I met him, a brain tumor had destroyed most of his ability to interact. Somehow, through the steroid-induced puffiness and slurred speech, hints of the little boy still inside him came through. His parents showed up weekly with piles of scribbled notes and printed brochures about alternative treatments they had found on the internet, desperately hoping that this time, finally, they would present us with something that held out a real chance for their son, something that we wouldn't be able to dismiss as worthless. After I'd been in the practice for a year, I could feel myself struggling. I wasn't sure how my colleagues managed it. Did they compartmentalize, harden themselves to the suffering, ignore the pain and somehow leave it behind at work? Or were they so secure in their faith that they found solace in God or Jesus or Buddha or whoever they believed was looking out for these poor souls. Did anyone really believe, as I often heard someone whisper after a child's death, that they are in a better place? Whenever I would hear this, I would inwardly grumble that if I truly believed that, I would immediately go there myself. The one time I ventured to ask a colleague if she believed in this notion of a better place, she quickly responded, "Of course," and looked at me, surprised. A devout Catholic, she apparently firmly believed that Jesus was waiting to embrace the departed souls of these suffering children. And this was a person I thought I knew well, someone who I thought shared my experience of working in oncology. Embarrassed by my own cynicism, I waited a long time before I asked anyone that question again. I continued to struggle, though. Do things happen for a reason? To teach us lessons? In other words, is meaning derived? Or is it just that human beings are capable of looking back on a tragedy and interpreting it in a way that allows us to make some sense of it and grow from it? In other words, is meaning constructed? The issue of agency, of whether or not there is a conscious, causative force behind these terrible things we witness, or if we are simply subject to the blind laws of nature, felt critical to me in the face of so much suffering. Studying religion in college had been stimulating, but the real-world experience of being a pediatric oncologist was proving too much for me to bear. As one patient's father, a curmudgeonly old science professor, told me on learning of my background in religious studies, "Ah, well, I suppose you're now just doing applied theology." But the applied version was turning out to be a lot harder to get my head around than the classroom kind. I turned to my father, in his capacity both as a parent and as a spiritual leader. How was I to make sense of all the death and suffering? How was I to engage in this kind of work day after day, fully immersing myself in the lives of my patients and their families, and still maintain the structure of ritual and belief that I had constructed? The suffering and death of these children argued against religion's kind, powerful, and loving view of the universe and the omnipotent being that ran it. I needed to find an explanation for this, to make sense of it all, or I would have to find a career with less exposure to it. My father's brutally honest answer, that he had no idea, was an acknowledgement that I had arrived at one of life's great existential questions and one of humanity's greatest challenges, to make sense of a world that all too often seems cruel and unjust. Theodicy, the attempt to explain how a good and all-powerful God can possibly allow evil to exist, tries to give us reasons why bad things happen to good people. Recognizing the ancient roots of this question, there is even a clay tablet dating from 1600 BCE inscribed with what scholars call the Babylonian theodicy, I resolved to take a closer look at how others have approached the problem. I loaded a backpack full of philosophy books and set out for 2 weeks in Guatemala, seeking a quiet place to get away and do some reading. Between excursions to explore the countryside, I claimed a favorite spot at a small cafe tucked into the crumbling Spanish colonial architecture of Antigua. There I would sit, dripping sweat and drinking warm beers in the humid Guatemalan summer, while poring over thick volumes, taking notes as I read. Unsurprisingly, there was no epiphany, no moment of glorious insight. But what I did begin to find during those weeks was a sense of direction, or at least of mission. Realizing how many others had agonized over the same issues made me feel less alone. I had no sense of where my career was heading, no sense of what I wanted from my personal life, no sense of how my faith system would hold up, but I felt that at least I was on my way toward finding, if not the answer to the question of theodicy, then perhaps an answer that would work for me. It was at the end of the trip, having not checked email or listened to the news for days, that I heard about the war in Israel. Sitting in the airport, I saw on television that an Israeli soldier had been kidnapped on the Gaza border. Shortly thereafter, there had been an attack by Hezbollah on the Israeli border with Lebanon, and the Israeli Defense Forces, IDF, were mobilizing on both fronts. This was all very worrying, and not for the first time did I think that my place was there, doing whatever I could to help. I had grown up in a Zionist home. I studied in classrooms where an Israeli flag hung side by side with the Stars and Stripes. Maps of Israel adorned the walls, and at least once a year we raised funds to plant trees in Israel. I had spent a great deal of time there, starting with summers as a child, then visiting more and more often and for longer periods from high school into my college years. To top it all off, I had lived in Tel Aviv through all 4 years of medical school. My sister had already made Aliyah, as had my brother, who, feeling a similar sense of duty, deferred law school in the United States for 2 years in order to volunteer to serve in the IDF. So it was not crazy that the oldest Waldman sibling was now considering a similar move, and I knew I would have my parents' support. Whenever I had thought about making Aliyah in the past, it had always been more of an abstract consideration. But now, already primed for a life change, I felt that the timing was right. The struggle of the Jewish state resonated deeply with my own internal struggle. When I arrived back in the United States, I decided that the next step on my journey would be a move to Israel. I'm sure this came as a surprise to many of my colleagues. Most of the physicians I trained with followed fairly traditional paths of slow but steady advancement in academia. But I already sensed that this path was not going to work for me, that in my search for a sense of identity and place, I needed to depart from the usual track. Where better to explore my faith and identity than in the country that I had been raised to think of as my other home? Prior to my official Aliyah in March 2007, I'd had a number of preparatory meetings with Jewish agency officials in New York. Their job was to help organize my paperwork and make sure I would be greeted at the airport, as all new immigrants are, with a warm Zionist welcome home. This was meant literally. I was told that someone from the Jewish agency's offices in Israel would be there at the airport, on the arrival ramp before the customs area, holding up a sign with my name on it. This person would set up my new immigrant's benefits package and give me my national identification card. At my last meeting with the Jewish agency representatives in New York, they gave me my one-way plane ticket and a letter to present on arrival, and they wished me well. On the appointed day, I excitedly headed to my new home. My parents saw me off at the airport, already talking about when they might make the move to Israel as well. I arrived on a rainy spring morning to a homecoming that was not quite what I had anticipated. As I walked down the arrival ramp at Lod Airport, tired from the 11-hour flight but beaming with pride, I scanned the area looking for the promised welcome home sign. Not seeing anyone, I queried one of the customs agents, who testily directed me upstairs to the immigration offices, where the staff was just getting settled in for the day. The clerk helping me apologized as she shuffled through piles of paperwork without finding anything with my name on it. She finally gave up and just started filling out all the forms from scratch. A short time later, I was on my way in a taxi to Tel Aviv, Israel's newest immigrant. My welcome hadn't been the triumphant return to Zion I had imagined, but no matter, I had arrived. And the bureaucratic hiccup on entry was even a bit charming in a you've-gotta-love-this-place sort of way. But as I began to settle in, I realized that my frustration with the government agencies that were supposed to be helping me had only just begun. Not long after my arrival, I received a short letter outlining subsidies I might be eligible for, including a modest monthly stipend to get me started, and a notice about tax discounts I could apply for on major purchases, such as a car. But other than that, in contrast to the warm sales pitches about the glories of Aliyah that I had been receiving from the Jewish agency representatives back in New York.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.